All right, news radio, Tommy.
So on the list, one that stuck out to me. If you won $10 million tomorrow, what would you spend it on?
A house.
Like a crazy house, or like a, like, would you spend $10 million on a house, or you would just use part of that $10 million to buy a house?
Well, I mean, part of it, because I would also make sure to buy a house for my mother.
Okay.
Good answer. I would probably help my brother out with his mortgage, you know, probably finish off his house, maybe a couple of friends' houses, maybe buy you a house. Or actually, no, I'd buy a house that you, me, Fallon, Michelle, and M. Fuck Kramer can all live in.
You mean...
I'll buy a mansion.
A compound.
Yeah.
Jacob Land Ranch.
We all have to meet together on Sunday mornings where we, you know, pray to the PlayStation gods.
Well, not the PlayStation. It would be funny if you picked, like, gods from PlayStation, like, exclusives.
We all worship Sephiroth.
And Kratos, and, you know, like...
This is the house of Kratos.
This is
the house of Sephiroth.
You're freaking the most brutal bastards out there.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I guess I said Kratos.
Oh, shit. But yeah, I know. I've actually kind of thought, it's like, if I ever came into a, like, over $1 million, like, it was, like, tax-free, you know, is a big thing as well. Because taxes are a fucked up thing.
Well, with this question to be, I think it's just $10 million. Yeah. Here's a briefcase, silver briefcase, click, there you go.
The golden light.
Yeah.
Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction, the light bulb.
What about you?
I've thought about it, too. I think it'd be really fun to start, like, a multimedia company.
I mean, yeah.
Like, you know, like, finance and produce, like, podcasts and arts, you know, for people.
I mean, that would be part of what the house is.
I just think that would be really cool.
There it is.
You know. Get your hands on... Just put your hands on everything. That sounded creepy. But, you know, like, be involved in... Like,
oh, video. Man, I just thought of some bad Donald Trump quotes.
Just put your hands on everything.
Just grab it.
I actually like these. I think I'm going to use them more.
Yeah, no, I like that. And we don't have anything, like, said. Let's keep that in mind. But let's get into this.
This is Tommy.
This is Jacob.
This is Tommy and Jacob's mixtape.
What happened to me?
Okay. This is Tommy.
This is Jacob.
This is Tommy and Jacob's mixtape.
Jingle bells. Wait, Batman smells. Robin laid an egg.
The Batmobile lost a wheel and the Joker got away.
Hey. Hi, guys.
That was in the Prisoners movie. And anyways.
Was it really?
Yeah.
Oh, right. Weird.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. How's it going?
Hope you're all enjoying the holiday. Actually, wait, yeah, what day is this coming out? This is coming out right before, this is the week of Christmas!
Yeah, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays!
Dashing through the snow.
God bless us, everyone.
When Grandma hit the deer.
Grandma got run over by a reindeer.
Could you, I just kind of want to, like, mishmash all, like, weird songs, just, like, misquote, like, missing. Christmas, 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 Christmas.
Tell them what we're doing today. Oh, it's also episode
116. And if you couldn't tell by the title, we are reviewing The Santa Claus, which I remember when I was a kid, the claws I thought was, like, the cleverest fucking thing.
It's
in the
pretty
world.
Clever.
It really is. But, like, as a kid, I was, like, super impressed. Like, wow, they thought about it so well.
It's a pretty, like, clever concept for what it is, you know. The Santa Claus.
The Santa Claus.
Released November 5th in Hollywood and
really?
November 11th in 1994.
I missed the premiere date. Yeah. I saw I didn't realize I was fucking, like, 8 years old when this came out. You were, like, 2.
Yeah.
Also, watching this, I didn't realize how much Tim Allen was in my house. Like, being played and whatnot. Like, there was a lot of Tim Allen.
Well, yeah, because around this time he was doing Home Improvement.
It was, like, one of my dad's favorite shows.
And he had a bestseller out, too.
A bestseller?
Like a book. He had a book out at the
same time. Oh, interesting.
I can't remember what it's called. I meant to write it.
How I Was a Coke Dealer and Came Out
and
of
a Drug
the other
Trafficker.
Side.
My we'll Life with there. Cocaine.
We'll get there to that. But yeah, so yeah, this came out of, what's your synopsis really quick?
An average Joe working man learns the meaning of family and the spirit of Christmas by literally killing and becoming the one and only Santa Claus.
Oh, the conspiracy of the elves. Have you read that?
No.
Oh,
this movie?
Oh, dude, I went down some rabbit holes with this.
I just was like, hey, whatever.
It's Santa Claus, whatever. And I'm like, no, the elves plotted and planned at all.
They didn't seem very upset about it.
No, they didn't. review-wise or rating-wise, I should say, this got a 6.5 on IMDb, a 73 tomato meter rating, and then a 65 audience score. Mm-hmm. So it's like all around about, you know, everyone kind of is just like,
yeah, Christmas. It's like Tim Allen. Santa Claus. Oh, oh, oh.
There are some like real Tim Allen moments in this fucking movie, though.
Yeah.
Like his like improv, it's just like, man, that was 100% him.
Yeah. Well, he just didn't do his catchphrase from, what did he do?
From Home Improvement?
Yeah. Hur, 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 hur. Oh, yeah. He would bark.
Oh, ho, ho, ho. He did it.
Yeah.
He did do it.
Yeah.
We counted 94 a while ago for like Pagemaster, but. Did you recount it, or did you get a different number?
I recounted it, but it wasn't a different... I didn't pull out the old notebook, but this time I counted it, I got 31.
And I was around 60.
Jeez.
94. I'm 8. Yeah, I'm watching a lot of movies.
Yeah.
And my mom's all like... a big thing was like every weekend, we would go to the video store and rent a new movie.
And this ranked number 4 for this year, too.
Yeah, which I was like, oh, we haven't had a movie in the top 5 in a long time. And I was surprised. It made sense that this movie would be in the top 4. Because of how big Tim Allen was at this time.
It's Tim Allen, Disney. Yeah.
Yeah. So. And it's also, it's a very original, take on Santa Claus and a Christmas story, you know? But yeah, let's get into a director, writer and all that stuff so we can get into review. Whoop. I don't know where that came from.
Director was, Joe Paskin.
John Paskin.
Quinn, who's worked a lot actually with Tim Allen.
Imagine that.
Crazy.
Mainly a lot of TV. He's directed a lot more TV than anything.
Tim Allen, Jungle the Jungle, 39 episodes of Home Improvement, Joe Somebody, Last Man Standing, 73 episodes. Just Tim Allen.
I think they're friends.
I would think so. And then,
do you think maybe Tim Allen's like, yeah, bring in John. He'll do what I want.
And then like not Tim Allen, Miss Congeniality 2 and 29 episodes of Roseanne.
Yeah.
Back in the day.
Was it just back in the day? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes more sense. The reboot.
Not the Connors. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it was Roseanne reboot.
Yeah, but then
we all know
what happened there. They just went, nope.
Oh, you think you can do whatever you want?
Bye-bye. But yeah,
that's actually kind of interesting to think about. Is like, cause like Roseanne turned out to be really conservative. Tim Allen himself is a very conservative guy, but he seems actually kind of like kind hearted.
When the
January 6th thing happened, he was really embarrassed. He's like, this is putting a bad representation of people that are conservative.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, this is a bad representation of.
Well, yeah. And apparently he does like a lot of philanthropy work for the homeless and stuff like that. So. But it's one of those.
What a good old white Christian guy.
Why'd you look directly at the camera?
Okay. I'm actually kind of excited to get into the writers of this.
Okay. Leo Benvenuti.
Thank you. Wow, I am kind of like. Out there, and Steve Rudnick, who they are a writing duo.
Yes, I noticed that.
They actually have a shared Wikipedia page, which I was like, oh, that's cool. But they've also like created a Space Jam and Kicking and Screaming,
which actually it's so weird. I just watched that last week.
Kicking and Screaming,
yeah, just for shit singing.
Like first time seeing it?
No, I just haven't watched it in a while, and it was like on HBO or something. And I was like, I don't have to really.
I don't think I really remember. I just remember Will Ferrell being Will Ferrell with kids.
Yeah, but like he's like he becomes a little league soccer coach.
Yeah,
but he's trying to win the championship against his dad, who's always like vying for his attention. So he starts unwinding and going crazy trying to beat his dad.
Oh, it's hilarious.
Like, discovers coffee and becomes like a coffee addict and is just wow. like very Will Ferrell kicking sounds and screaming. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Quite literally.
I would kind of like, I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, it's not, and he's not going to be credited, but I wouldn't be surprised if Tim Allen himself helped, you know, rewrite a lot of this shit.
Well, yeah, I could definitely see him.
It's a very Tim Allen-esque type thing.
No, it'd be great. If I set fire to the turkey. Yeah, yeah, sure, man. Sure. Sure. How'd you get in here?
Why is your wake nose up. Covered in white?
Wake up.
What's all over your nose, man?
God. How'd you get in my house?
Jumps out the window.
Like, yeah, what if he just took the Santa Claus thing, like, really seriously?
God damn.
Jumps out the window. Andrew Oliver, good night! Running down the street.
That's making me think of a robot chicken with Captain Planet.
Ted Turner.
Yeah.
Is that oh. what it's called, the zipline? Yeah, I think it's called Captain Planet!
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay. So, yeah, I mean, I guess we can just, like, transition into starring. I mean, so, yeah, Tim Allen, which I'm actually kind of surprised this is our first Tim Allen movie. Actually, no, he hasn't done a lot of movies, though.
He had, like, 53 credits or something. Yeah. Well, because even then, what would we have done?
Wild Hogs, maybe? I don't know.
I mean, Wild Hogs would be kind of fun.
Galaxy, we've been wanting to do Galaxy Quest for a very
long
time.
True. Like, that's the only one I can think yeah. that we've mentioned.
Yeah.
But, like, we don't really do animated stuff that often. So, that Toy Story, he's Buzz Lightyear.
Yeah. And then really, like, Joe Somebody, I kind of remember that. And then Christmas with the Cranks with Jamie Lee Curtis.
That's actually pretty good. That's a fun...
Yeah, that's fun, but that would be, like, one of our Christmas movies, you know?
Yeah, but that's one of those, like, everything goes wrong ones, right?
Yeah.
Trying to pull Christmas back together.
Yeah, because they were getting ready to go on a vacation.
Yeah, yeah, that's a cute one.
And then the Shaggy Dog where he turns into a dog.
What is Joe Somebody about? Because even that's why I put Average Joe, because of Joe Somebody.
It's kind of like that. It's just like an Average Joe type story, dude. I've never seen it.
Oh, okay. So, never mind.
I mean... I vaguely remember like it coming out and it just, yeah, it's an Average Joe rising against the odds and it's Tim Allen.
Being Tim Allen.
Yeah. Yeah. The interesting thing with Tim Allen.
Big Trouble.
Oh yeah.
We could have done Big. Yeah. Big Trouble is something I'm mentioned to doing.
He started out, in stand-up comedy actually as a joke. He was dared. His friends dared him to go and like do it like at some like place in Detroit. And then all of a sudden he was good at it. And so he kept doing it. And then he started like doing like reoccurring like television commercials. And like Detroit had like their own like kind of like SNL thing, like sketchity comedy. I'm going to call it for that from now on. Sketchity. And yeah, he was just like was good at it. And then he got busted and arrested in 1978. For drug traffic. He was selling... It's a fancy way of saying he was a coke dealer.
He had like 1.5 pounds of coke. And was like, wow.
Yeah, he was selling coke.
And his mugshot's great too.
Yeah.
Do you see it?
Yeah.
He's got the big old 70s mustache.
Yeah, he looks so young too.
He was a baby.
He's like mid-20s. Like, holy shit.
He looked like a baby.
Yeah, I know. And he was... I'm just like... It kind of puts like a weird like thought in my mind. Like, all of his friends daring him to go up and do comedy. He's like, how much coke were they doing? He's like, you know, be fucking awesome, man. You know, be great. You know, be funny.
Well, then he did 2 years.
Yeah, 2 years in prison.
And he's one of the few that, like, I was reading that Disney has a very no felony working with people that have felonies law, like, clause in their contracts. Like they're like, nah. If you, we're not. You know, they don't want the Disney
drug clause.
Yeah, they don't want the image of Disney to be tarnished.
Yeah,
that's a funny statement. But he's one of the few that apparently does.
I just wanted to make so many inappropriate jokes right there.
I think everyone could read between the lines on what I'm talking. They don't need Mickey Mouse busting to the door. What'd you say? Say it again, motherfucker! Say it again! Where's my money? Sorry. The coffee's kicking in.
So you were saying, like, they have, like, a no drug. Like, you're saying that it's kind of weird that they work with him? Or?
Well, I thought it was interesting. He was one of the few that they, like, are like, that's okay. It's just cocaine.
well, I mean, he had a. He he had a really big turnaround after that. It's like, you know, he went to prison. He stayed in, like, the good graces of a lot of people, and then just, he started his own production company, and...
It was so far.
Yeah, I think it's, like, so far away, and, like, the success that he had with what he was doing, and his character, Tim the Toolman Taylor. And then also his success with stand-up comedy. He's the reason I know the word verp, a vomit burp.
I've never actually listened to any of his stand-up.
See, this is me. I'm like watching this. I was like, and thinking like, now that we're doing like all this review stuff, I was like, realizing like Tim Allen was very big in my mom and dad loved his stand-up comedy. We watched Home Improvement all the fucking time.
I remember watching a lot of Home Improvement.
Yeah,
and it must have been like
Jonathan Taylor Thomas,
Nick at Night, or something.
Oh yeah, because I watched it air.
Well, because that was like the lineup. It was like Nick and I was like Roseanne,
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air,
Fresh Prince,
Home Improvement. That's so funny for you. That's what it was. Nick and Knight for me.
Cosby Show.
Whoa.
Yeah. Really, that was definitely one of them.
Because Nick at Night when I was a kid was I Love Lucy, I Dream of Jeannie. All in the Family and shit, like 60s, 70s sitcoms on reruns.
Interesting.
Nick and Night for You was like, oh, the 90s, my childhood.
And then it became like the George Lopez Show.
Yeah. And I think Friends was on it for a minute.
I don't remember that, but whatever.
It's
not neither here nor there.
Yeah. God damn, yeah. I need some Sudafed. Sorry, guys, if I'm like coughing and like all sniffly. I got some weird sinus infection thing going on.
Do you want to see if I have Halls in my back?
No, right now. And Halls isn't going to do anything. And also, I'm not going to suck on a cough drop in front of a microphone.
You're right. That would drive me nuts.
All right. So really quick, also starring in this movie, we have Judge Reinhold, who is most popular, I think, of his role in Fast Times, Ridgemont High, and then I recognize him from movie Vice Versa with Fred Savage.
I think we talked about him briefly in Gremlins.
Yeah. Yeah. Because he has that small cameo in it. He's supposed to have a bigger role, but never did, apparently.
Yeah.
Wendy Crewson, who, I mean, Air Force One. I didn't really recognize her from anything, but I saw that she's in Air Force One.
So she's probably the first lady.
I think she's the first lady. And then The Sixth Day, I would assume Arnold's wife.
Yeah.
Yeah.
These are also movies I haven't seen in a minute.
Yeah. No, I was like, I couldn't really know. I couldn't see anything. There was nothing on her list where I was like, oh, that's where she's from.
And I'll put on.
And if it was anything, it would have been this movie.
Well, it's like The Sixth Day too. I remember I brought this up. I watched it not that long ago, but I don't sit there and actually watch the Sixth Day.
The clone one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't sit there and actually watch it. I just have it like
on.
There.
Yeah.
It's like on.
And then, yeah, Eric Lloyd plays his son. Who's done, when he was a kid, he did a handful of voiceover work. I really remember him from this movie and then Dustin Checks In, which when I saw that name, I was like, holy shit, he did a movie with a monkey. Yeah. I don't know what the fuck it was with the early 90s or mid 90s and like young kids with animals, but there's a lot of those fucking movies. We've talked about this before.
Mm-hmm. Like a lot of times we've talked about
this. And it's in this year. It's Dustin Checks In. There's another one with like, I think I want to call it Polly or something. With I can't remember whatever.
Polly the bird.
Yeah,
I love that movie.
Oh no, it's not Polly. But there is that one. That's with the girl with the curly hair.
Yeah,
there's another one. I don't know. Anyhow, and then David Krumholtz, who plays Bernard in this, the lead elf, which apparently in the Santa Claus lore, he is the son of the Santa Claus previous.
Is that why he's so big?
Yeah. Which we'll get into that dark side of the Santa Claus a little bit later.
But yeah, David Slums of Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
Wednesday Addams, Love Interest, and Addams Family Values. Yeah.
We brought him up a couple, like about a month and a half ago.
And then 10 Things I Hate About You.
Yeah. God, he's great in 10 Things I Hate About You.
Yeah. He is, Joseph Gordon-Levitt's best friend. Mm-hmm. If you can't put a face to the name. Wasn't he like the LARPer, like Shakespearean dude?
Yeah, well, so I actually remember the character's name from Taming of the Shrew, because you know that movie's based off Taming of the Shrew, yeah. But then it literally was like, yeah, that's the, that, I mean,
that's,
and then a bunch of, Peter Boyle, I want to give a Who plays
yeah,
the boss?
Yeah, no, he's also in the because
he plays Father Time in the
second
one.
Yeah,
third one,
second one. Yeah.
There is a woman that has this like weird TikTok like theory, and she brings up like why is Disney casting Peter Boyle as Father Time? Like, what is happening here?
Because he's the boss of everybody, I guess.
Yeah, but
because he's time.
This kind of gets into this. Well, all right, let's go into the reviews.
Okay.
And let's talk about the movie. And or should I do the? But should I do my theory first? Should I share my theory first? That I read. Let's do the reviews. You already leaned over.
Yeah. Okay. So for this movie, it had 7 positive, 6 mixed, and 0 negative, which I was actually kind of surprised about.
Yeah, actually.
Just because it's a Christmas movie, yeah. I thought someone would rip it apart for...
Well, I mean, for a Christmas movie, I feel like this is pretty done, well done for a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
And also, like, who's going to, like, it takes a real asshole to be like, fuck this Christmas movie!
A lot of people hate Christmas, man. They do. Anyways. 90 out of 100, Leonard... Claddy at Variety. This is a hip, likable spin on the seasonal icon told with a deft mixture of comedy and sentimentality. Which I was like,
yeah.
Yeah. And that was also the highest one. Who did I pick? Hollis. 50 out of 100. Hollis Chacona at the Austin Chronicle. This souped-up sled is a perfect vehicle for TV star slash comedian Tim Allen, and despite its formulaic chassis, he takes us through a few interesting twists and turns.
Okay.
And the reason I picked that one mainly is because I was talking to my partner about it too. Never in a million years would I have thought of casting Tim Allen as Santa Claus, but he actually is a pretty great Santa Claus.
Yeah.
And I've watched the entire like franchise except for the Santa Clauses. But even with, like, as, you know, like, from the first one, you know, going to the third, they kind of, you know, like, but he's still enjoyable to watch as Santa Claus.
Yeah.
And especially once you get through the transformation and into the now, he is Santa Claus and he lives in the North Pole.
He actually looks like a really good Santa.
Yeah, he looks like a good Santa. He's, like, really charming, especially with his elves, you know. He's really, like, cute and he's funny with them. And he's still Tim Allen, but he has this, like, warmth.
That's kind of like a thing. It's like you realize kind of through this that Tim Allen through like whatever, like, because I feel like a lot of people just immediately associate him with Home Improvement, especially mm-hmm. this time period.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, Tim, the Toolman Taylor, you know, it's like,
Last Man Standing is just the Home Improvement.
He's too. Pretty much the same guy.
Yeah. It's Home Improvement too. In a lot of ways.
And well, there's also the whole thing in like Home Improvement, like he's the guy, he's the man's man type thing, but then like, you know, because he's a man, he's an idiot as well. And the wife is always getting, you know, blah, blah, blah. Sitcoms of the 80s and 90s.
Well, I was going to say like Dan Connor. I was like, John Connor, wait, that's something else. Like Dan Connor, same kind of thing. He's the man. And
the Terminator meets Roseanne. Oh, God. Yeah. Like
there's the formulaic of that. Like,
But you kind of see that Tim Allen himself, like he is a very warm-hearted, nice guy. It feels like, you know what I mean?
It feels like that, especially as like the Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Like he's,
well, it's like, there's definitely like, he's that dad that's going to be kind of like serious and gruff with you, but He's not gonna say I love you, but you know he loves you.
You know he does. The pat on the back.
You know, when you fall down and you scratch your knee or whatever, like you have maybe you messed up at the ball game and he's like, it's okay, son.
Well, it's just like I was reading that one of the people they were thinking about was Bill Murray.
Yeah.
But he didn't want to because he had just come off of Scrooged.
Yeah.
And he didn't want to do another holiday movie like right then and there. But it's like thinking about Bill Murray in this role, it doesn't work.
No, it doesn't.
It like, you know, it's kind of like I was reading also that this is completely, but just kind of like the same idea is that Jim Carrey was thought of for Buddy and Elf.
Yeah, that's right.
And
yeah.
And it doesn't, there's something about it that doesn't work.
Well, I mean, but that's, it doesn't work because of the product that we got. Once they kind of cast these guys, they start having the writers
mold it to that person. Like you said, he probably had some ideas.
Yeah. Because, you know, it was Bill Murray and Chevy Chase were originally offered.
Excuse me.
Tom Selleck, Tom Hanks, and Mel Gibson were also considered for the role. Like anyone, like Mel Gibson. Well, he
could have probably worked actually.
Yeah, for this time.
Well, because I'm thinking of like what women want Mel Gibson, yeah. like that kind of shrewd businessman.
Yeah. Well, but that's the thing. Scott Calvin isn't a shrewd businessman in this.
No, you know what I mean? But like, you know, work is like kind of main priority. I did like that.
That's though. Actually, no, that's a thing. That's a very interesting thing about this movie is that Tim Allen, like Scott Calvin, he isn't some horrendous person that needs to be redeemed.
No, but I mean, still, work comes first. He's at the work party for his toy line, and he's lying about the traffic.
Yeah, that's fair, yeah.
But it's also like, but that's also something I liked, is I liked that they just went to, the parents have been divorced for a while now.
Yeah.
That story arc is done. We don't have to sit there and watch that.
Yeah.
Like, which I thought was kind of, like, that's just...
No, it's like, actually, in a weird, so, if you guys are interested, there is, and if you like Dan Harmon, he has a 20-minute rant about... More about Seth Santa Claus 2.
Which is really weird, by the way. I just watched it last night.
Yeah.
It's very bizarre.
But the first, like, 5 minutes of him is him kind of, like, giving, like, a relay of, like, him watching the first Santa Claus. Because him and his, like, partner at the time, they watched the first Santa Claus and the Santa Claus 2, like, back to back. And the way that, like, his breakdown of the first one is kind of, like, and he's right. It's, like, how this movie starts off with him being, like, already like he is a nice guy, he doesn't really need a redeemable quality, you know. It's about he wants to actually spend time with his son, he's just bad at it, you know.
Well, yeah, but that's the redeemable quality.
Yeah, exactly. So, but like it's like the way that he is, like, as Dan Harmon describes, is like this is how most third acts of movies are set up. Is like you already have it, like he's like, so for we're already at him being at kind of his best, this movie's gonna get super fucking like deep possibly, and it goes awry in the weirdest non-logical sensical shit ever.
Well, yeah, and also like I didn't realize this movie's an hour and 43 minutes long.
Yeah,
that's a long ass Disney Christmas movie.
Yeah, it is.
And like in like comparison, like I went to go play and I was like, this movie's an hour and almost 45 minutes long. The hell happens in this movie? Oh, a lot.
Like, a lot happens, and there's also a lot that doesn't need to happen.
But yeah, it was.
I have a lot of torn feelings about this movie.
I do like that they just kind of skipped ahead to the parents are divorced. They have been for a while.
Mm-hmm.
There is no rekindling possibility. It's that they're divorced. Yeah. They're fine with it.
Yeah.
They're cool. They're cordial for the kid.
Yeah.
We skip all that will they, won't they bullshit.
Yeah.
Which was kind of like refreshing, especially at this time.
Yeah. We don't have this Mrs. Santa Claus until the second one.
Yeah. You know, and there's not like liar where because he becomes a good father, they rekindle, you know, it's just like.
Well, that's because the kid actually wants his parents to be together. Like this kid just like wants to spend time with his dad.
And his stepdad too.
Fucking selfish, dude. Like his dad, it's like fucking, never mind. The very end where he's like, it's like his dad just like, oh, I got to go drop off all these presents. And then the kid's like, I want to see my dad now. You just said, I want to see him now. It's like. Fucking A, kid, let him fucking deliver presents.
I was watching it and I told my partner too, I was like, this kid is absolutely driving me nuts. And she was like, he's so adorable. And I was like, there's something about this kid that's driving me nuts.
He's fucking selfish.
He's just so, why is everything I want to do stupid? It's like, shut up. Anyways.
Did you have a third review that you wanted to read?
I don't know.
We just went, I mean...
I'll be here with you.
I mean, generally you have three. I know since there was only like the positive in the mix, there was no like negative. So,
yeah, like I don't know. Like,
yeah, no, that's fine. We don't have. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Like it's weird about this movie is
like none of the reviews actually stood out to me. So I'm like kind
of whatever. It's like the logic of this movie is bonkers. Like. This the whole.
So, like, for people who don't know, the Santa Claus persona is transferable.
Yeah,
it is itself a parasitic disease that destroys your identity and forces you
to become
Santa Claus. In the clause itself, it says you will like. Yeah, I meant to like look up the actual clause,
all that stuff,
but like it literally says that, like by putting on the suit. You therefore
agree to discard
any identities, hence or therefore.
Yeah.
It's like, you're, like kidnapped.
No, and Bernard's like, all right, so you have until Thanksgiving to get your affairs in order, and then you're going to come back to North Pole on Thanksgiving, and we're going to start doing this thing. And he's like, I'm sorry, what? I'm not coming back Thanksgiving. He's like, yes, you are. Well, and also, they're kidnapping.
Or we'll come and get you.
They're kidnapping the dude, pretty much. Yeah. And like.
Well, because also, so like, it, like on the card, it says, put on the suit. The ranger will know what to do. And then a teeny tiny. It looks like the border of the card is the rest of the contract.
Is the clause.
Yeah, it's so.
No, and that's where I was like, that's where as a kid, I was like, the clause, it's so smart. And I think I'm pretty sure that's where I learned the word clause as well.
They probably got this for idea from all the people that they've screwed over.
Nice.
Oh, God, I heard him. He's coming.
But like, it's like when Tim Atwood, Scott Calvin shows up at the North Pole. Also, these that fucking elf just standing there like, sup, bro? He looks like some like bad 90s hip hop wannabe.
My first thought too is like this high tech North Pole. So the pole has to come out, but then someone physically still has to come up and like
Santa. It would have been Santa that does it, but since it's a new Santa,
I don't think so. He's king. Type in the numbers, peasant. I think there's a lot of dark stuff happening at the North Pole that they just weren't showing us.
Man.
This is a fun movie. I'm just going to say that I'm going to start here because I know that we're going to go down this rabbit hole. This is a really fun movie to watch as an adult and read between the lines about a lot of stuff. That's all. So I would actually like to hear your conspiracy theories or your.
Yeah, that's fair. Because, I do want to say this is actually for a Christmas. This is a very wonderful Christmas movie, actually. And very, very. I think it's well crafted for the family all around. It's mainly, I feel like, directed for children, you know, because you want to believe in Santa. You want children to believe in Santa. But like some of the Tim Allen stuff, there is just like this little bit. There's like these small little things where you get like for mom and dad, like here and there.
Yeah. Like, are you going to your mom's for Christmas? No, we're going to Neil's parents. Oh, you're going to the pound. Yeah. You know, like he's, you know, him jabbing at Neil constantly.
Yeah. Oh, did you notice that the cop, when the elf force, whatever showed up, the cop was reading a romance novel.
I did.
I was like, that's a little out of place. Okay, so did you notice the elves that are like planted throughout the entire
film? Anytime there's like a group of children, there's an elf. Yes, I did catch that.
More or less, yeah. Also, I do want to point out a nice homage to A Christmas Story at the very beginning with all the kids looking through the.
And one of them's an elf.
The toys, yeah. But one of them's an elf, it's like that's the family and kids.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. Totally. Okay.
It's very much that's the opening of A Christmas Story. Yep. I was like, this is a sweet homage to that. I like that. The idea of this theory is that all of the elves planned for the Santa Claus, at the beginning of the movie, the current Santa Claus, they murdered him. They planned his murder, his death. And they were setting it up and they scouted out Scott Calvin and they wanted Scott Calvin to become the new Santa Claus. So that's why all the elves are around.
Keeping tabs.
You know, they're making sure that that Santa gets pushed off the roof or some shit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Which is why when he shows up, because like it's so weird when he shows up, all the elves are just like this fucking new guy. They're not like, where the fuck is Santa?
No, straight up one of them goes, look, the new Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Like in the background.
It's like
no one gives two shits.
Yeah.
No one gives, and I thought that was hilarious.
And Bernard is just like all like, blah, 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 blah. Like, not going to say that.
off mic.
Think about his last name. Bernard is, and he's just like all like, it's he's just kind of like trying to just push Scott Calvin along. Like, it's the fact that they don't like, also the fact that when he shows up, they're not like, all right, hey, check it out. You're now the new Santa Claus. You're going to have to do this for the rest of your life now.
For eternity.
we don't even know. I think that's what the Santa Claus is about. He's been doing it for like 30 years now.
So they got to replace
him.
And
he's getting old, too old maybe.
I mean, yeah. I mean, even like in the clip I saw, Bernard looks older. And I was like, aren't you an elf?
Yeah. Like, I think that's also going into the fact that he's, half Santa Claus is.
I don't think they're going to tie in your conspiracy theory.
No, that's, I think that's actually a confirmed thing in Santa Claus 3.
What?
That Bernard is, oh, maybe that is part, maybe that was part of the, one of the theories that I was reading. I read a lot of weird shit last
time. I think you're just starting to, like, yeah, no.
There's... But like, no, like the whole thing is like the elves planned for Scott Calvin to take over.
Yeah.
And then apparently there's more that kind of gets into Santa Claus 2 and 3, but I haven't really watched those ones. So I'm just kind of like over my head, but I do know Santa Claus 2 is a great departure from this wonderful, like, warm-hearted, like, Santa Claus story, origin story.
Well, yeah, Santa Claus 2 is also so weird because he has to get married.
Yeah, otherwise he will no longer be Santa Claus anymore.
And, like, this one of the elves, like, overlooked, like, he's the keeper of the code for North Pole, like, overlooked this clause and didn't tell him. So now he only has 28 days to get married, or he'll get desanctified. So he starts reversing, like, you know, he starts losing weight and losing his beard.
Yeah.
So there's like a bunch of like, oh, look, I'm fat jokes.
But they like create like a fucking like robot Santa, don't they?
Yeah. The second time Tim Allen's played a toy, I guess. Yeah,
he's like got some like kind of major like fascist dictator
shit going. Yeah,
because
because they give him the book and he like reads it and he's like, we gotta follow the.
Follow the rules of Christmas.
It's so weird. It's like you said, it's such a departure, and just the concept alone, like you have to get married. So he goes and finds this woman and like seduces her with the magic of Christmas. It's so, I was watching like. That's fun to do.
good old Tim Allen, yeah. Just noises.
But it really was. It was so bizarre. I was like it's still like, again, that's what I'm saying is like watching it as a, because even like this the first one,
yeah,
it's so fun to watch it as an adult because, like you were saying, at a certain like the kid wants to go off with Santa.
Yeah, well, he wants to go off with his dad.
Yeah. But like. And you're like, oh, they're going on a Christmas adventure to deliver toys. But then to mom and the stepdad, he kidnaps the child.
Yeah. No, he flat out kidnaps his son.
But then the kid calls from the North Pole and is like, yeah, mom, we're just making toys. Yeah. And
it's like,
no, but from the perspective of the other parents.
Oh, yeah. No, they're like, what is happening?
Where is he?
Yeah. It's like, no, that's like this movie. It's like it is legit. Like, but like also the conflict of stakes that they have, like. When it's before, we know that he before like the like he is like doing the Santa stuff, and his kids just walking around be like, no, my dad is Santa, and everyone's like, you shouldn't say that. It's like type thing, like even like Tim Allen's like, hey, let's keep it a secret, you know. And I feel like as it like he handles it very well as a dad,
because but, like you're little, you don't understand. I can't exactly explain to you what's happening right now.
Yeah,
so let's just keep it a secret, and we'll cross that bridge when we get to it.
But then how his like stepdad and mom like go off the rails, unreasonable on like being like. Like Tim Allen, like Scott Calvin is doing this on purpose. Also, like, if this man is gaining weight at this rapid pace, don't be worried about the fact that, like, something else happening.
No, but that's the thing. So it starts off with mild concern because the kid is just obsessed with Christmas. Yeah. And the season's over.
And you should be like, it's like, okay, my kid's just going to be weird. He's going to be the weird Christmas kid.
From the mom and the stepdad's perspective, it looks like the dad is drastically changing his appearance to fit the delusion this kid has. So again,
despite him being like, no, I'm not doing, I don't know what's happening.
That looks like bullshit. That he's looks like bullshit.
You are gaslighting us and our child.
Because even then, what does he decide to do? He decides to wear red and green.
No, it's he literally like his entire personality starts to change through all of this as well.
You would kind of be concerned. But again, as a Christmas movie, watching it as like a family, you don't think that. But if you're looking at it from the other parent's perspective, this is fucking terrifying. This is a Christmas nightmare. Bye, Chapstick. But yeah, I was like cracking
it's like,
up.
And like all of that is all well and wonderful. And I think that's like, I feel like the best part of this movie is kind of that whole like Santa transformation. I do think the parents go a little bit far on like trying to like take away it, take away his visitation rights there, or their split custody. I get to that point and I'm just kind of like, why are we sitting down and just having like an actual conversation about what's happening to you and whatnot?
Well, yeah, because the biggest conversation they had was just yelling at him at the soccer field.
Exactly. So it's and like, for something that where it's like, he's like, no, these kids literally just lined up next to me.
But no, but that's even the thing. Okay, so
it's like he's actually like completely innocent through all of this.
Yeah, but he's got like white hair and a big white beard. So he looks like a little old to be a parent watching the soccer game. And he's watching the soccer game. And then suddenly there's a line of children just hopping on his lap. I'm like, this is not a thing anymore. This is not. The cops would be there so quick. Your head would spin. This is kind of a jump back, but I thought of something kind of interesting to go into your
theory,
your murder of Santa Claus theory. Yeah. Something I thought was really weird is that, you know, Rose such a clatter. Charlie, is that his name?
The kid, yeah.
Yeah, Charlie. Charlie wakes up his dad, and they're like, holy shit, like, you're right, there's something on the roof. And then they go out there, and then Scott's like, hey, you, what are you doing up there? And then he falls down. I was like, the Santa Claus is loud as hell.
Oh, that's part of the theory.
And is that the elves? He was like drugged or drunk or something. Because he's even all like, whoa.
Yeah, they like drugged him, but they also, they specifically had like their elf magic or whatever to wipe away the masking of Santa being on the roof for Scott Galvin's per specific house.
Well, that doesn't work though, because everyone sees Scott Calvin once the cops are looking for him.
Because he hasn't figured it out yet. He's only been Santa for like 1.5 years, man. I don't know. We're questioning the logic of a man that turns into Santa Claus. Like,
the elves did it.
Santa, this is a world where Santa Claus exists.
Santa Claus does exist.
Oh, get fucked.
Now you get cold. But yeah, no, it doesn't look great for Scott Calvin.
No,
it really doesn't look good, like, at all.
To top it all off, when he does kidnap his son at Thanksgiving. Also, Bernard's like, I don't got a problem with it. It's like, motherfucker, you should. Like, come on. Like, he's got other parents. He's got a mom.
Oh, I didn't realize that was Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
He was kidnapped for a minute.
Yeah.
For some reason, I thought that was like Christmas Eve dinner.
No, it's fuck. Because Bernard's coming to get him for Thanksgiving.
You have until Thanksgiving to get your stuff. And then he's like, yeah, come with me. So he like took him for a month.
Yeah.
I didn't even realize that.
That's why when he calls, the parents are like, are you okay? He's like, yeah.
This poor mother.
I know, right?
Oh my God, I think this is my new favorite Christmas movie. This is awesome. This is terrible. Oh my God.
Oh my God. And that's like,
that is incredible.
Also, the whole like, the like flame retardant like suit and like all like the montage of him getting ready for Christmas, I think, is one of the most that is the most like forced into this script for kids moment. Even like when they're walking and all of a sudden the dance, like, yeah, little dance, I'm like, what is happening?
It's whimsical for the kids. It's the idea.
And that's how we got Santa Claus too.
Well, yeah, it leans
hard into that shit.
Like, really hard. Well, because at this point he is. The fun thing about this movie is the average Joe,
yes,
churning into Santa Claus.
Yeah.
And him dealing with, like, you know, he drastically starts gaining weight. He starts going gray really quick. He gets a beard seconds after shaving, which even then, too, once he gets to the point where he's full white and beard, I'd just be like, ex-wife, what's her name?
The ex-wife?
Yeah.
Oh, I can't remember.
Laura.
Sure. Yeah.
Laura, okay.
Yes.
You need to, like, either come over or let me come over and let me show you this.
Right? Like, there's...
Let me show you what happens.
I have proof.
I have proof.
It's like, watch this. Like, I'm gonna, like...
Dye...
Hey, help me. Dye my hair. Shave my beard. You know what? Let's see what happens. Yeah.
And then... And be like, there.
They should be like, oh my... Could you imagine watching that happen? And they'd be like... Satan!
Yeah, like, burn the witch! there's one scene in this that I don't really know how to word my feelings towards it. I don't like it. But Neil and Laura talking about when they stop believing in Santa Claus.
Oh.
I could so not. It's such a, like, because we've already.
That was one of the more grounded moments of the entire film.
Well, no, but it's one of those. But I just felt it was too. We're supposed to be, aw. Because it's like the whole idea, too, is like, you know, he already, she, what's her name? Judy. Judy already explained that, you know, it makes sense. Most adults can't believe in magic. They just kind of grow out of it. And it's kind of like, we don't really need this weird, I didn't get my toy explanation. Because also he's like, I was 3 years old. It's like, sounds like you, like, the levity.
Okay, Jeffrey Dahmer.
The levity of it is like, I was 3 years old when I saw my dog get hit by a truck. You know, it's like this really high levity to it.
And yeah.
And it just doesn't feel,
I mean,
genuine to me.
That's fair. I mean, there's, honestly, there's a little bit of just Judge Reinhold's performance in this is just kind of little over the top. And
dude, he is smackable like a mother. How does that?
Oh, yeah.
Charlie, I think we should talk about our feelings. I'm like, ooh, I want to kick you in the chin.
Yeah.
But I get he's like, a psychiatrist, but
I get what you're saying with that. I feel like it's one of the more grounded moments, but it's also
I think it's grounded. I just didn't need it.
It's a foreshadowing for them to believe later when they get the gifts that they never got. It's like when they, and also it proves the magic of Santa Claus because Scott Calvin wasn't there to hear that.
Yeah, but
that was
also
a private conversation.
But I think a better moment for that is when they both, Neil and Laura separately, first Laura and then Neil, are just looking at Calvin now that he has completely embraced the magic of Santa and Christmas, and then it just like clicks, like it almost unlocks.
I mean, he did that.
No, I'm saying you just need that, because that was actually really, when she's just staring at him and she just starts welling up and she's like, holy shit, this is actually Santa. Like it unlocks like the childhood.
You can tell like like Neil is starting to go a little bonkers, because when he's like Santa and then he reverts back and he's like
his eyes go all wide. Yeah.
And then he's like, but wait, no, we're feeding into his delusion.
He's pulling us into his delusions. That made me laugh really hard. He's just like,
and then Bernard's right there. He's like, where did you come from? Where did he go?
Starts, like running around the house looking for him. That was pretty funny. But yeah, like it's that transformation thing that happens. Even like Scrooged. The best moment is Scrooge is when he's going through his transformation and meeting the ghosts.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with Tim Allen. It's like, you know, the whole denial.
But it's like a reverse in a weird way. Because like there's. Yummy. It's more like it's kind of like in reverse because. Or it's just different because like for Scrooged. He's a horrible person needing to get redeemed for this. This is more, it's Scott Calvin has no redemption. It's him just accepting that he's Santa Claus. It's the reluctance of, it's like the reluctance of the hero story.
I guess, yeah, because even with the whole, like what we talked about in the beginning of the episode, or like, you know, when we start, this whole thing is like, he's kind of a workaholic. He still cares a lot about his son, but work still in a sense comes first. But then throughout this movie, he just gets now a year long, a 365 day job where he's going to live at the North Pole and never be around his kid, which is a big plot point in the second one that Charlie's feeling. He's a teenager now and he's feeling a type of way because he doesn't ever really get to see his dad.
Oh.
So they just kind of shot that through it. You know what? Fuck it. We don't need that.
Okay.
God, this movie's great.
It's weird. And you know, I will say this is like for it's definitely a good Christmas. I don't really care. I don't care about rewatching it again.
I think I watch this like every year.
I feel like it's really good for kids. I do. It's very heartwarming at the end once Tim Allen accepts that he's Santa, and he just kind of has this like Santa charm, like when he's like just going to the house, he's like, I am now Santa Claus.
Or even when he gets arrested and they're like, like asking what his name is, and he's just saying it in a bunch of different languages.
That was fucking funny. That was a Tim Allen moment.
That was like Santa Claus, Kris Kringle. And he's just like going through all the I liked that. That's the thing. I was just pleasantly surprising that he did so well. You know, it's like Jim Carrey in The Grinch. It's great. He's a great Grinch. He's a great Santa Claus. And, you know, it's kind of what I heard. And I haven't watched him yet, but like in the Christmas Chronicles or the Santa Chronicles with Kurt Russell.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Apparently he's a really great, like, kind of modern day Santa Claus because he's not like, he's kind of like a hip, cool Santa Claus. And I've heard he's really great. So I'm going to check that out. Those are all on Netflix too.
That came out a couple years ago, didn't it?
Yeah, I wonder if it's like this kind of period Santa Claus.
Possibly.
You know. I mean, like, the only like kind of weird thing is I'm sure someone would might. There's a lot of like. There's a lot of. I was going to say a lot of fat jokes. It's not really fat jokes. There's a lot of weight jokes, which I'm sure someone.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's just. I think like that's product of the time.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, like, especially the classic image of. The consumer Santa Claus is a big fat guy, you know, the big white beard.
He's a jolly big man.
Rosy cheeks, you know.
So. I mean, that was Coca-Cola.
Yeah, you know. But I mean, it's like, I'm a big guy and I thought they were funny. He's like, little weight? This looks like a little weight to you? Yeah. I'm like, I feel you.
Oh, dude, I love it when, like, the doctor, like, is checking his heartbeat and it starts going to the rhythm of Jingle Bells.
Like, you know, like, I thought they were, or like, you know, when he first comes back to, like, the real world and he goes to... he goes to lunch with his like coworkers.
He's at the business meeting.
Yeah.
And they order lunch.
But yeah, he's like, I'll take a Caesar salad, no dressing. Ooh, and one of those like chocolate chip cookies, the warm ones, you know, just that. Ooh, and that cheesecake. And and he just like goes, and then he's sitting there and he's eating every last piece of fudge, and then when it pans out, you notice he hasn't touched any of the Caesar salad.
No, I didn't notice that. I was noticing everybody else's plates were half eaten.
But also, I thought it was funny because all the sweets were gone. The veggie was still there.
Yeah.
Because the veggies is what you give to the reindeer. There were no reindeer.
Oh.
I thought maybe that was a joke.
That could be it. I think it's more like his diet is just changing to only what you would eat around Christmas. That's also like the logic of what Christmas is a very built like identity of what America has created Christmas as.
Well, because the magic of the presents, that's how he convinces people that he's Santa. Because that's even the second one.
Mm-hmm.
That whole idea. All you eat is sweets.
Yep.
All he drinks is hot chocolate.
Eats candy canes. Eats hot fudge. Like, he just eats chocolate, sugar,
but he's
sugar,
still, sugar. But he's still very healthy.
Because he's magical, yeah.
Yeah. Which I was like, that sounds great.
It does sound great.
Doesn't it? Like...
Well, I mean, for me, it'd be just...
Cheese?
Other stuff, yeah.
Cheese and eggs.
I miss cheese and eggs.
But yeah, I mean, like I said, like, I think this movie is really fun for... It's a fun family flick. It hasn't... The special effects haven't aged well, but...
No.
Whatever. Because also, there's not that much of it. Because so much of the movie is his transformation. There's a couple reindeer scenes that are just kind of whatever. But...
Well, there's also, like... I think, like, the best moments of the CG were really, like, his regrowth of the transformation. Mm-hmm. That's actually really cool. Him going into the chimneys looks a little but I thought was actually, like, the make, like, what the radiator that turns into the chimney.
I mean, that was cool.
Yeah.
That was cool looking, you know, like, that was fun. And it's explaining how, you know, because those are always the kids' questions. It's like...
fucking Dan Harmon has a joke about that, too. And he's like, because this is what they would imagine, like, poor people's houses to look like with a radiator. And, like, parents, like, when we were, as a kid, I wasn't told that Santa comes down the chimney all the time. Like, we didn't have a chimney. How is Santa coming here? He comes in through the fucking front door like a normal human being.
Well, way to ruin the magic. Or, like, even that, like, when he's still, like, he's forced to do it the first day and he's, like, being really mean to that little girl. It's funny. Like, I'm lactose intolerant.
Yeah, because, he was also, like, learning the reins.
He was kidnapped.
Yeah. Let's wrap this up and get our rating words.
I say 3 out of 5.
Yeah, I'm down with that.
It's good. And it's like, and like I said, it's really fun to, like, show your, like, younger people, like, your kids or your nephews or whatever.
There's definitely, like, minor complexities of this movie that I never noticed as a kid. Like, what was it? Fuck, I forget what it was. Like, just like the like real human elements where, like, as a kid, I was like, oh, this is really funny to watch Tim Allen become Santa Claus. But like the journey of that, I was like, fuck, dude, this is fucking dark and deep, weirdly.
And if you're an adult, watch it as the Santa kidnapping.
Yeah.
And kind of like the, what we were talking about with, like, look, think of it from the other parent. It's kind of fucking hilarious. Not like kidnapping's funny, but it's like, it's under such a red and green Christmas guise that if you just swap the filter and you think about it from other perspectives, you're like, this is kind of twisted.
Yeah.
Like,
it's like, you're wearing nothing but Christmas clothes now all of a sudden. I like this. What are you talking about? I guess
with that, you could go with the, you know, like the change in diet and everything. Mm-hmm. It's also the change in taste and clothing.
Yeah, I know. You know. Yeah, everything. Yeah.
But I mean, I think, you know, to think about it, like, yeah, like the, him showing up and the elves not giving two shits about the other Santa Claus, you do, even without you telling me like that theory, I was sitting there, I was like, that's really weird that they're just like, hey man, not like, who the hell are you? Like, how'd you get Santa's sleigh? Yeah. They're just like, what's up, new Santa? Like,
or even just like someone like, ah, fuck,
not again,
or fell off the roof again,
or like, yeah,
shit,
or even like run up, it's like, what happened to Santa Claus? Oh, he fell off my roof. Oh no. All right, anyway, so, you know, something, I don't know.
It's like, or just like, whoa. Oh, did he fall off the roof?
Yeah, so you like, that's the thing.
Is, like, what? Did he fall off the roof? Did he fall down the chimney? Did he, like, what? Tell, explain a, how? Why are you wearing the clothes? Just tell me.
You could have written anything.
Yeah.
To like, and you didn't.
Yeah. You apparently, know, even Tim Allen had said something about, like, he felt that was a weird what is it, plot hole?
Yeah.
In the entire thing, but he was like, man, it's like, whatever, it's a Christmas movie. Just have fun.
Yeah, like, it's either a pretty big plot hole or you. Like, you, yeah, I don't know. I don't know how you would have missed that.
They did. It's there in the movie.
You watch it, get the spec script. It's like something way darker. The elves decide to brutally murder Santa Claus and replace him with an imposter.
That's the Bill Murray version.
That's the Bill Murray version.
And the multiverse.
Scrooge 2, Frank Cross gets taken.
Oh, God.
All right, I'm done.
All right. Well, guys, that was our holiday block. This is Merry Christmas for the weekend. Oh, yeah, you guys are listening to this. Next week, we're going to be going into New Year's.
Yeah, did we have
that? I think we're doing the movie New Year's Eve.
I think so.
Yeah.
I have to look at the calendar.
I'm pretty sure that's what we got.
Yeah. All right, well, everybody, like, follow, subscribe, comment, suggest. Tell your friends.
Communicate
with each other.
Scream into that, into the void.
It's the time of love and presents.
Merry Christmas.
Happy holidays. And we'll talk to you on the
New Year. Yuletide joy.
We'll talk to you on the New Year.
Yeah, guys.
Krampus is going to get you. Ha! This is Tommy.
This is Jacob.
This is Tommy and Jacob's mixtape. I guess.